I want to set a little time aside this morning just to deal with a very practical subject, one that we've all experienced. You may be experiencing it now. You will if you haven't. Everybody goes through a storm, and it takes a storm. We would like a very peaceful existence. We would like everything to come up roses. But storms are a part of life, and so many times it is actually the storm that God uses. Albert Einstein said this, "In the midst of every crisis lies a great opportunity." In the perfect storm, there is a perfect opportunity. I was thinking about that when I'm putting together this message, and I remember when I was a kid, I went to a camp with my brother. It was a camp where it had a lake, and you could walk out into the lake onto a raft. The other side of the raft was a deep water. I didn't know how to swim, so I would make believe. I would walk, and I would do this. So I got out to the raft, and my brother and I got up on the raft, and he pushed me into the deep end. All I remember about that is I was kicking, I was hollering, I was waving my arms, I was fighting, and I learned how to swim. Because sometimes it takes a storm to create a breakthrough. I wouldn't suggest you do that to others that don't know how to swim, but for me, that's how I learned how to swim. The Lake of Galilee is an interesting lake because of where it is positioned in northern Israel. It's 13 miles long and 8 miles wide, and because of its location, a storm could instantly blow into the lake and turn it into a tempest. When Nancy and I visited Israel, we went to Lake Galilee and we stayed at a restaurant where we went to a restaurant. And the way they serve fish there, they don't cut the head off. It's the whole fish is brought to you on a plate. So he asked for chicken. I can't do that. But it can be a dangerous storm. Sailing in broad daylight is fairly safe. Sailing at night is risky. Jesus has spent an entire day teaching the crowds. On the same day, when evening had come, Jesus said to them, "Let us go over to the other side." Jesus had been teaching. The crowds left. When they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat. And a great windstorm arose. I like the way Mark put it. It wasn't your regular windstorm. It was a great windstorm. And the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. You know, when you get ready to go on a trip, I get in the car and Nancy and I are going to go somewhere. I'm hoping for a peaceful journey. And most of my journeys are peaceful. This one wasn't. They got into the boat, hoping for a peaceful journey, when they ran into a storm, a major storm. It was major in the sense that it was now a perfect storm, because not only were the waves crashing into the boat, the waves were crashing onto the boat. And Jesus was sleeping, and it was late at night. This is a perfect storm. A perfect storm is when you have lost control, when you no longer can steer the boat. The wind will steer it, the waves will steer it, but you have no longer the control of that boat. That's a perfect storm, and that's what the disciples were in, a perfect storm. The wind, the waves, the night, the water coming in, they're bailing. And Jesus is sleeping. That's odd. The disciples are biting their fingernails and Jesus is sleeping. The disciples are rowing for all they are worth, but Jesus is sleeping. The disciples are in panic mode, but Jesus is sleeping. They are nervous. They are uptight nervously. They are tense, going to become past tense. And Jesus is sleeping. We don't want Jesus to be sleeping. We're in the middle of a storm, that we have lost control of the ship, but the disciples are bailing as fast as they could, but the waves kept. Waves can be angry. They have no feelings. They will come and they will dash against whatever ship we happen to be in, and they will have no regard for how you feel. Waves are angry. You ever run into an angry person? An angry person, you get a torrent of verbals and a lot of verbiage. And so many times what happens when a person becomes angry, it was because they were afraid. It's fear that actually drives anger. When a person becomes afraid, you know, it goes like this. Men don't want to be known as afraid. So when fear hits, they go right to anger because it's cool to be angry. It's macho. It's not. It's dangerous. It's disastrous. It creates problems. You know what? When we are afraid, you know what fear, when fear comes, because it will come to every one of us, when fear comes, that's our moment to start strategy. If our strategy is anger, that's not a strategy. That's a devastation. So now the disciples are in a boat. They are facing an angry sea. And in this angry sea, Jesus is sleeping, and they are trapped because God got them into the boat. Wasn't their idea. Have you ever experienced anything like that? You did what God said, and now all hell is breaking loose? Lord, you got me into this thing. I was minding my own business, and suddenly, boom, everything is going wrong. I don't understand. We're trapped. Some people are trapped in a job. Trapped in a relationship. Trapped in an emotion. Trapped by fear. Trapped by bitterness. Trapped by resentment. Trapped, can't get out. They don't know how to get out. Want to get out, but can't get out. They're trapped. These disciples could not get out. Have you ever felt trapped? That's what the disciples were feeling, trapped. Now, when we face a crisis, and it is scary to face a crisis, we don't normally think that the crisis itself can become the opportunity. But it can. And in God's hands, it will. We just need to start thinking out of the box, because typically what happens when we go into crisis, we go into panic. But if we come into God's presence, Lord, I don't know, I don't understand. I am trapped here, and I need, is there the possibility of an opportunity in this mess that I'm in? I quoted Albert Einstein, who said that in our crises, so often there is the stuff of an opportunity. And he's right. And the Bible is filled with examples of it. The disciples are trapped, they are stuck, but the opportunity is staring them in the face, but they can't see it. When you're afraid, you don't see it. You don't see the opportunity when it's looking at you. And the opportunity is this: Jesus is in that boat. He's within arm's reach. Your opportunity is there. Jesus said, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. He is right there in the boat, and you are within access of him. That's your opportunity. Come. go to him. He's sleeping, and I know that gets us upset because we would rather him not be sleeping, but wide awake just like we are, but he is sleeping. We'll get to why he was sleeping a little later. And they do come. This is what it says. He was in the stern, asleep on the pillow, and they awoke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" I let that go over and over in my mind, and you can't help but feel this way. Do you not care that we are perishing? They're putting it in the negative. It's their mistake. It's also our mistake. We come to God with the idea that he doesn't care. So we whip out a prayer to a God that we don't believe really cares about the mess that we're in, because it seems like he's sleeping and we're rowing. If you look at the Lord's Prayer, this is the prayer Jesus, actually it's not the Lord's Prayer, it's our prayer, but it's called the Lord's Prayer. If you look at the Lord's Prayer, you will discover there's nothing really negative about that prayer. Jesus tells us to come into the Father's presence. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. There's nothing negative about that statement. It's a plea. The prayer is designed for a child, and so it's the child coming to the Father. We are the children, and we are coming to the Father with our plea. Give us this day. Forgive us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. That's the child's prayer. The disciples are not praying like a child. They're praying like a skeptic. Do you care that we're perishing? Can you imagine giving God a tongue lashing? I think maybe what we need to do when we go before the Lord in prayer, especially when we're in a storm, and usually it's going to be a storm that causes us to come rushing into his presence and asking for help, is set a little time aside to sing a song. Oh yes, he cares. I know. He cares. I think we should sing it even if we don't know. Because if we sing it enough times, maybe we'll start to get to know. I know he cares. His heart is touched with what your heart is touched with. When the waves are crashing, the lightning flashing, I know. My Savior, the fact that his title is Savior means he's there to rescue. That's why it might be a good idea for us to take a little moment out just to sing a little song before we actually come into his presence, so we don't come with a negative attitude. Do you care that I perish? Lord, I know you care about me. The scripture says this, for we know not an high priest which cannot be touched with just the feelings. Just the feelings. Forget about anything else. It's just the feeling. If the feeling comes, if the feeling of anger comes, if the feeling of fear comes, if the feeling of sickness comes, whatever the feeling, he is touched with the feelings of our infirmities because he cares. So when we go to him in prayer, we need to go with the attitude, he cares. Because he does. I've been going through the life of Paul in my devotions during the week. And I thought of something that interests me, because he was in a lot of crises. I mean, if there ever was a man that went into one storm to another storm to another, it was Paul. Paul was always in a storm. But there's one storm I want to bring your attention to. He was in a crisis. He was arrested, brought to trial, and the high priest hired a famous orator to come in and present the charges, making Paul look pretty bad. Paul simply listened to the charges, and then he said something to this effect. Excuse me, but can a Roman citizen be condemned with charges that cannot be proven? And immediately the powers that be knew, you cannot condemn a Roman citizen for an accusation that cannot be proven. That was a privilege of a Roman citizen. Paul is a Roman citizen. He is standing before Governor Felix, and Felix, who is corrupt, so corrupt they had to withdraw him from his position. He was corrupt, and instead of dismissing the case, which he should have done, because there was no evidence, he decided to use a technicality and put Paul under house arrest, supposedly to run an investigation. But Luke tells us there was no investigation running because Felix wanted some money under the table from Paul, who's a tent maker. He got no money. But Felix knew he represented the church, and the church had money. And Paul would not use church funds to pay blackmail. So Paul is stuck. He's under house arrest. Can't go anywhere. He's got to cancel all his campaigns that he had planned. He can't preach anywhere. He can't hold healing service anywhere. He cannot witness for the Lord. He can't go to the Gentiles. He can't do any. He is stuck. He's under house arrest. There he is. That's his perfect storm. And I would imagine Paul went to pray. Now, we don't know what he prayed. I happen to know. Well, because I'm a minister. I know things. And this is what his prayer was. There's no doubt in my mind he said this. Lord, you called me. I did not call me. And you chose me. And I did not choose me. And you sent me. And I did not send me. And they are blocking and stopping your work. Two years under house arrest. And we don't know at what point God did this, but at some point the Spirit of God came to Paul and simply said, write letters to the churches. Paul started writing letters. At being under house arrest, he had the access to write letters. He wrote letters. He couldn't leave. He had to write letters. Had no idea. His letters would go all over Europe, all over Asia, all over Africa, all over North and South America that wasn't even in existence at the time. Nobody even knew about it. Over all of the world, hundreds of millions of people would read the letters he wrote while he was locked up and shut down under house arrest. Because God can take a perfect storm and turn it into a perfect opportunity. That's the God we serve. And what we need to do is we have to stop trying to figure out how God's going to fix the problem that we're in. You know, I have ideas. I would like to share my ideas with God, and he laughs. He has his own ideas, and we can't even go where he goes because his ways are beyond ours and his thoughts are way beyond our thoughts. Moses is the people are complaining. The children of Israel are complaining to Moses. They are hungry, and God sends manna from the sky. And when they're thirsty, God gets water out of a rock. Who would have thought of that? So forget about thinking. Just go to the Lord in prayer. And I think maybe this is a good idea. If you're going to go to God in prayer because you're in a crisis, in a difficulty, you'll never go wrong if you present God's word to God. Lord, I just want to tell you that I did not write, God is my refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Those are your words. I did not write, you are a strong tower. You said you were a strong tower. They're your words, they're not mine. So I'm coming to you just simply to repeat what you said. You said you were my hiding place, that I could find myself in that secret place where God would overshadow me under his wings. I'm just telling you what it is I read in your word, Lord. I just want to share your word with you. You said no weapon formed against me would prosper. I didn't write that. You wrote that. You said, if God be for me, who can be against me? Lord, you wrote that. That's your word. I'm in a storm here. And you said, if God be for me, who can be against me? Which means nobody can be against me if God is for me. I'm in the middle of a storm and those waves are coming my way. I need help. And you said you were a shelter in a time of storm. I didn't say that. You said that. So I'm just presenting your word to you, because I know there's something about your word that your word can make a way where there is no way. There's something about your word that can move mountains. There's something about your word that can part the sea. There's something about the word of God. It's just the word, your word. You said, let there be light, and suddenly out of pitch darkness comes light. Your word is powerful. So I'm looking for your word. I need your word. I'm coming to you with my storm. And my storm needs to hear something. Maybe what we need to do is just remind the Lord that we need him. I need you more than ever. I need you more today than when I first believed. You know why, Lord? Because I'm in over my head. And you are the head of the church. I need you more today than when I first believed. Because my hands are tied, and you can stretch forth your hand and part the sea. I need you more than ever now. I'm stuck. I'm defenseless. I'm helpless. This storm is bigger than me. It's stronger than me. I'm weak. Things are looking down, Lord. But I lift my head to you. We sing sometimes, turn my eyes to you, O Lord, because I need you. This storm is more than I can bear. You promised you would be there. It looks like I'm out, but I read somewhere that I am in Christ. I just want to point that out to you, Lord. I need you. That's the way a child comes to God. That's the way Jesus taught us to pray. Like children. Because that's who we are. It doesn't matter what your age is. We are children. We're just a bunch of kids. And we need the Father's help. Next week is Father's Day. I'm going to talk about the Father. Our Father. Jesus, Master.
Master.
This tempest.
The tempest.
Is raging.
Is raging.
And if you don't come and help me, this tempest is going to take me down. You're the master of the wind and the waves. I recognize who you are. I come to you because I need the master. I need your help. Jesus comes. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. It seems so simple the way Jesus does it. You know, the disciples are going crazy in a storm, and they wake Jesus up, and Jesus simply gets up and has an argument with the wind, which he wins, and is a great calm. Because that's what Jesus can do. That's what he can do for us. That's what he can do for you. Bring peace in a storm. When storms come, they come to break us. They break us down. And maybe that's why the storm came. But regardless of why it came, that's what it does. It will come to break us down. The scripture says this, the Lord is near to those who are of a broken heart. Broken. And save such as be of a contrite spirit. There is something in God's word that keeps rising up, and that is that God will exalt a humble person and he will put down a proud person. He does not appreciate pride. He ran into it in heaven when the devil tried to raise his throne above God's, and Jesus said, I saw him fall like lightning. God is against pride. He's against that arrogant attitude. And he's drawn to humility and brokenness. So when we come to God broken, because we are broken. It's being transparent, being honest with God. There was a show, The Muppets, and Dolly Parton appeared on The Muppets. And she's talking to Miss Piggy. And Miss Piggy said, Dolly, I would like to be a country western singer just like you. And Dolly said, you want to be a country western singer? She said, yeah, I want to be one just like you. How can I be a country western singer? And Dolly Parton speaks to Miss Piggy and says, you need to have your heart broken. Because if your heart is broken, you'll become sensitive. And your sensitivity will produce compassion. And your compassion will come through your voice. Because God is near to those with a broken heart. When you go back to the story, you read, I know the question that you're going to ask yourself is, why was Jesus sleeping? I had a problem with the fact that Jesus was sleeping simply because water is coming into the boat. It's not like Jesus was sleeping at a high position. There was water in the boat. Jesus is sleeping even though the water is in the boat. Why would he be sleeping? And we're not given, we're not told in Scripture why he was sleeping. But again, I figured it out because I'm a pastor. It's amazing what you can do when you're a pastor. I know he was waiting. He was sleeping because he was waiting. He was waiting for the disciples to run out of ideas. Waiting for the disciples to become limit up. Waiting for the disciples to be at wit's end. Anybody here at wit's end? Don't know what the door, this is a storm. That's wit's end. Jesus is waiting. This is waiting. He's waiting for us to get to the place where we realize I got no more options. I don't know anything. I'm waiting. I'm just waiting. He's waiting. He's waiting for us. Waiting for us to make a move. And there's one other reason. Jesus is sleeping because there is no emergency. We are in an emergency. But he doesn't see it as an emergency. Because he said, all power and all authority is given unto me, and I have the power, I have the authority to handle this situation. Just simply come and ask. And maybe if we would be willing to come into his presence humbly and ask, he will show us that what we thought was an emergency was putty in his hands, clay in the potter's hands. So we're in a storm. One. Maybe it's a perfect storm. No storm has ever come to stay. They come and they go. And we have access to the storm walker and the peacemaker. Listen to the words of this song.
Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky.
Maybe somebody here today is facing a storm, something that seems to have gotten out of control. Jesus is in the boat, within arm's reach, waiting. I'd like to open up this altar for those that want to come and spend a few moments before the Lord. I'll be glad to pray with you. Sometimes we just have to do something physical, like get up and go down. Not because the miracle is here, it's because the getting up and the going down is like saying, Lord, I really mean this. I really mean this. This is a storm. As we sing the verse and the chorus, this altar is open.
Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the